Joyce Meyer Ministries dankt haar donateurs die deze uitzending mogelijk maakten.
Now let's look at three places in Proverbs. Proverbs 15, 18. A hot-tempered man stirs up strife, but he who is slow to anger appeases contention. Proverbs 16, 32. He who is slow to anger is better than the mighty. And he who rules his own spirit is better than he who takes an entire city. You know what it means to rule your own spirit? It's this whole thing that I'm talking about self-control and not just going with every feeling that we have. Come on, let's get honest tonight. How much are you ruling your spirit? How much are you ruling your fleshly feelings and your emotions, your words, your thoughts, your feelings, and how much are they ruling you? This is the place that we're at. This is like the next thing on the blackboard to grow in. Don't think you came here for no reason. You didn't come just to see what I look like in person. Well, maybe you did, but whatever God uses to get you in, that's fine with me. We got to get ready for the war that's coming. We got to get ready. The Bible says that in the day the Lord returns, people will just be going about their business just like everything is just as normal as it can be. And suddenly, like a thief in the night, Christ is going to come. And there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. We don't want to keep putting stuff off. I'm not going to be perfect when Jesus comes back, but I'll tell you what. I want to be further along than where I am right now. I don't think it matters to God that we're perfected or not. He already knew what he was getting when he got us. But I'll tell you one thing, God wants to see us pressing on, and he wants to see us serious about growing up in him and doing things God's way. Jesus has given us a new life, and he says you got to put off the old man and put on the new man. And you can do it, but you need to want to. You need to really want to. You need to want to enough to pay the price. Proverbs 22, 24, and 25 even say don't associate with somebody that's angry, lest you learn their ways. So this is a pretty serious thing. There are many angry people in the world today. Now, some people have been angry so long they don't even really know that they're angry anymore. They've just become bitter, cynical, negative, critical. A lot of angry people are depressed. That's the root of their depression. Not all, but some people just have all these unresolved issues in their life. Do you know how long I was mad that I was sexually abused by my father? And I didn't go around really consciously aware that I was mad about that. But anytime that you've had something taken from you that you have a right to have, if you didn't have a father, if you didn't have a mother, if one of your parents was an alcoholic or there was a problem and you were cheated out of something, there's a part of you that says, that's not right. And I fought the world's way for a long time. I was angry and harsh and hard. And nobody was going to push me around. Nobody was going to tell me what to do. And I was trying to be a Christian like that. I loved God. But I had not gotten serious enough with God to say, I want to do it your way. And I think maybe if there's any benefit that I might hope to be to the body of Christ, it's in helping believers mature and grow up. It's time to get rid of our diapers, our pacifiers, and our baby bottles. Babies can act however they feel, but it's not very attractive on a 40-year-old man. Woo. It's a good thing we had a good time with God before I started this. The Bible even says in Hebrews 12 that we should watch out for one another, lest any root of bitterness and resentment get in among us. So let's help each other. When somebody's telling you their sad story about how mad they are, encourage them to let that go and give it over to God. Tell them what a waste of time it's going to be, and just encourage people. I know it's not right, and I understand why you feel the way you do, but, you know, can we pray together and turn that over to God? Would you be willing to give it over to God and let God be God? You see, God didn't like what happened to me when I was a child either. I wasn't the only one that didn't like it. He didn't like it, and actually, it made him angry. Now, God is not an angry God, but he can get angry. And he gets angry at injustice, but he knows how to fight the right way. Got to learn how to fight like a Christian. Let's look at Mark chapter 3. Again, Jesus went into a synagogue, and a man was there who had one withered hand as a result of an accident or disease. And the Pharisees, you know, the Pharisees really annoyed Jesus. And they actually did make him angry. It was a righteous anger. It wasn't a wrong anger. There is anger that's wrong, but there's also a righteous anger. And the Pharisees kept watching Jesus closely to see whether he would cure him on the Sabbath so that they might get a charge to bring against him formally. And he said to the man who had the withered hand, now, I love this because, see, this goes back to what we're preaching last night. Jesus knew that he was about to make him mad, and I think he kind of arranged to do it on purpose. So he said to the man with the withered hand, get up and come and stand here. He didn't even do it in private. He said, come here and stand here right in the middle. Woo, I love it. Come on, just get out here. If we're going to do this, let's just really show the dumb people. I mean, if Jesus didn't want to make a ruckus, he could have just kind of took the man off to the side and not stirred up the Pharisees. But he wasn't going to be controlled by them. Verse 4, and he said to them, is it lawful and right on the Sabbath to do good or to do evil, to have life or to take it? But they kept silent. And he glanced around at them with vexation and anger. Everybody say, Jesus was angry. Grieved at the hardness of their hearts. And now, I hope you can make this jump with me here. So what did Jesus do next? And he said to the man, hold out your hand. He held it out, and his hand was completely restored. So now, boy, if we can get this tonight, we can learn how to fight like God would fight. We can learn how to fight like a Christian. These people made him mad. And instead of turning away from his assignment from God and arguing with the Pharisees and trying to convince them they were wrong, Jesus' response to the anger that he felt was to heal a sick man. Come on, we'll sneak up on you, but you'll get it. The only way to fight like a Christian, the only way to fight like God, is to overcome evil with good. From the beginning of time, we have been in a battle. The earth has been in a battle between good and evil. It has always been raging. It started in the garden, and it has never stopped, but it is escalating today, especially in the Western world. Now, a lot of these things, I mean, the rest of the world has been so bad for so long that we can't even imagine. And we need a great return of morality. But in the meantime, those of us that do represent God, that are what he calls the light of the world, we have to press in like never before to represent Jesus, to be Christ-like in our behavior, and we have to learn how to fight like God would fight, and that is you don't return evil for evil. You don't return anger for anger. But when somebody does you wrong, you go out and help somebody else. Now, this is really a spiritual secret, and a lot of people never get it. They just never get it. But I hope that you can get it, and I hope all the people watching by TV can get this. If you can learn how to fight like this, you will win every battle. And I know that some of you, when I share these things, I can see the looks on some people's. It's almost like you're disgusted with my whole message because you're just thinking, don't even try to tell me that I'm supposed to go home and be nice to this jerk. Listen, I didn't say you need to let people abuse you. I think that there are times when we need to exercise what I would like to refer to as controlled anger. And that's the kind of thing where somebody's not treating you right, and you know that for their sake, you need to confront them. You pray about it. You ask for God's perfect timing. And then you go, not in a rant and a rave and a rage, and you calmly tell them, you are mistreating me, you are disrespecting me, it's not right, and I don't intend to live like this. And can I tell you this? Sometimes the less you say, the greater effect it has. Too many words means nobody remembers anything. Boy, that was good. You know, I just did not act good for the first several years of our marriage, and just angry. And you know, people that are angry down deep inside, you just don't behave well. And Dave's a very patient, long-suffering man, a very godly man, and he had no intention of not trying to see things through to the finish. But I'll never forget one day, we were in the back bedroom of the first house that we owned, and we had a mirrored closet, like a double door closet, and the whole thing was mirrored, and he was standing in front of part of it, and I was standing kind of back over here, and he turned around and he looked at me and he said, you know what, if I depend on how you treat me to tell me what kind of a man I am, I'd be in bad shape. And he said, if this continues, I'm just letting you know right now, I don't know what I'll end up doing. Didn't say nothing else. Wasn't angry, didn't shout, didn't yell, but it was time. It was God's time for him to confront me. Now, did anybody hear what I said? You know, you're not going to get anywhere if somebody's yelling at you and you're like, God, I'm going to treat me that way. And let me tell you about it. And then they go, you're a bad. And then the kids come in the room, they're like, and then after about a half an hour of that, you don't even know what you're fighting about. All you know is you're mad. Come on, you'd pay a lot for this at a psychiatrist's couch. And you got in here free and was only asked to give a love offering. I'm saving you a lot of trouble. Is anybody understanding me? I know what I'm talking about. God revealed, thankfully, that secret to me in the Word, and I can show it to you in 10 scriptures. Where the proper response to being mistreated, to being abused, is to pray, bless, and do good to overcome evil. It is a secret that the devil cannot understand. Mean people cannot understand it. Only a believer in Jesus Christ can understand it. It is the only way for a Christian to fight and ever win their battles. Now, I know that that's irritating to your flesh. I get it. Because we're so mad. I'm so mad. Do I look mad? I'm really sure. I'm so mad. And if you think that you're gonna treat me that way, and God is saying, really? I mean, really? Has that ever worked? Is anybody in the building ready to try God's plan? Now, it will be hard on your flesh because you may not get instantaneous results. Let me tell you a secret that I've learned. Sometimes you have to do what's right a long time before you get a right result. So if you're only going to try this once to see if it works, you know, I'm not offering you a magic charm tonight, you know. Somebody mistreats you and you go help some little old lady across the street, now all your problems are solved. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about lifestyle here. I'm talking about, devil, you've got enough of my life. You're not getting any more of it. I mean, listen, as long as we keep buying into the enemy's system, he can make us mad 50 times a week. We're mad because somebody cut us off in traffic, and we're mad because somebody took our parking place. I don't have no time for that anymore. If I'm waiting for a parking place and some goofball comes and whoosh, I just, bless you. Hope you enjoy that. Well, that's not right that they did that, and I'm not going to put up with that, and I'm going to tell them off. Okay. See you when I come back in a couple of years. We can talk about it again. It's up to you. You know I'm right. There's always going to be somebody out there to annoy you. Getting mad about it's not going to make them go away. God uses them. For all you know, God arranged for that guy to be there to get that parking place. Just to pull out of you the very thing that he wanted to pull out of you. Amen. So hopefully you would finally see it and deal with it. Because if it's in you, it's going to sneak out. Romans 12:17, repay no one evil for evil, but take thought for what is honest and proper and noble, aiming to be above reproach in the sight of everyone. If possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave the way open for God's wrath, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. I think we needed to be reminded of this. But if your enemy's hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. For by doing so, you will heap burning coals upon his head. Do not let yourself be overcome by evil, but overcome and master evil with good. Psalm 37, 1 through 8. Verse 1. Fret not yourself because of evildoers. One day I read that scripture and a lady out in the audience yelled out, "That's me, Sister Fret." Fret not yourself because of evildoers, neither be envious against those who work unrighteousness. That which is not right or in right standing with God, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as the green herb. Trust, lean on, rely on, and be confident in the Lord and do good. Trust, lean on, rely on, and be confident in the Lord and do good. Here's the way to fight like a Christian. When there's an evildoer that has done wrong, don't fret yourself, but instead lean on, rely on, trust in, and be confident in the Lord, and while you're trusting God, do good. You know, if you can learn to understand this, the devil will finally get smart enough to go bug somebody besides you. I mean, if every time he attacks you, you're going to go bless somebody else, why bother? Yeah, you'll laugh a lot more when you really start doing this. Trust. Lean on, rely on, and be confident in the Lord, and do good. And you shall dwell in the land and feed surely on his faithfulness, and truly you shall be fed. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. You know, now, we're still talking about when the evildoer still being evil, how we're supposed to behave. Commit your way to the Lord. Roll and repose each care of your load on him. Trust, lean on, rely on, and be confident also in him, and he will bring it to pass. You know, the first thing to do when somebody mistreats you is to say, "God, this hurts, and I'm angry about it. But I know that my anger won't solve the problem or change the person. So I trust you, and I'm going to keep my assignment. I'm going to keep being a Christian. I'm going to keep my light turned on. I'm going to keep doing good because that's what you put me here for. And I'm going to commit my way to you, delight myself in you, and I'm going to watch you bring to pass what I could never do, not in a million years." Verse 6, "And he will make your uprightness and right standing with God go forth as the light, and your justice and right as the shining of the noonday. Be still and rest in the Lord. Wait for him and patiently lean yourself upon him. Fret not yourself because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who brings wicked devices to pass." Verse 8, "Cease from anger." "And forsake wrath, fret not yourself, it tends only to evil doing." So when evil happens to us, we don't want to respond with more evil doing. We want to overcome evil with good. Well, anger is an emotion that we all deal with. But it's what we do with that anger that determines whether it becomes a real problem or not. So let's pray and ask God to really help us exercise the fruit of self-control that he's given us, and to always be quick to turn away from anger, then we can experience God's peace that is so amazingly enjoyable.
Meer dan 10 miljoen gevangenen zitten wereldwijd vast.
It's a hostile territory here. Prison. And I'm speaking proof of that.
Zij die achter zulke muren leven zijn mensen. En Jezus vraagt ons om naar hen om te kijken.
I'm here for third degree burglary.
I have a lengthy sentence of 400 months.
The judge looked at me and said, I'm going to sentence you to spend the rest of your natural life plus 20 years behind these prison walls.
A lot of people don't have family here, so they feel forgotten.
There's not a lot of people beating the door down to get in here to see us.
That outreach of the hand to touch their lives in a personal way, to come visit them, to see that somebody is really thinking about them, that somebody cares for them on the outside.
You're giving to people that really are like at the bottom of the totem pole. And with your giving, that's actually bringing somebody up.
It's the fact that you thought about us, even if it was just to come by and have prayer.
We just feel loved, you know, that we're not pieces of garbage, you know, thrown away, that somebody does value us still. And that there is hope, there's hope for us.
Tot nu toe hebben we meer dan 3600 gevangenissen bezocht. Zijn er meer dan 3 miljoen cadeautasjes uitgedeeld. En meer dan 139.000 gevangenen hebben voor een leven met Jezus gekozen.
You know, the Word of God teaches us that if we are willing to share what we have, God can multiply that and make it into a lot more than what we started with. So please share.
Help ons om andere mensen te kunnen helpen. Bel ons 026 20 22 100 of ga naar joyce-meijer.nl/partner. Elk gebed en elke donatie telt. Samen veranderen we de wereld.
Zelfbewust te zijn heeft alles te maken met vertrouwen op God.
Dit is precies waar het over gaat in het dagboek van Joyce. Je bent wonderlijk gemaakt.
Vertrouw op God en weet dat je waardevol bent voor Hem. Hij geeft je de kracht om nieuwe dingen te doen en hiervoor je gaven in te zetten.
God heeft je wonderlijk gemaakt om moedig en vrij jezelf te zijn. Met dit dagboek voor vrouwen ontdek je elke dag iets meer hoe kostbaar je bent voor God. Bestel Je Bent Wonderlijk Gemaakt door te bellen met 026 20 22 100 of online via joyce-meijer.nl/wonderlijk.